All right, well, let's stand and worship God in song this morning. My foes are many, they rise against me, but I will hold my ground. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, my help is on the way. Oh my God, He will not delay, my refuge and strength always. I will not fear, His promise is true, my God will come through always, always. Trouble surrounds me, chaos abounding, my soul will rest in you. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, my help is on the way.
His hand. Song's just a chance for us to just stand before God and surrender to what He's got for us.
Here I am, down on my knees again, surrendering all, surrendering. Find me here, Lord, as you draw me near, desperate for you, desperate for you. I surrender.
Drench our souls, Lord.
Drench my soul as mercy and grace unfold. I hunger and thirst. I hunger and thirst. With arms stretched wide, I know you. Like a rock. like a mighty storm, stir within my soul. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way. Like a rushing wind, Jesus, breathe within. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me. Like a mighty storm, stir within my soul. Lord, have your way.
Sing this a couple more times. Just take time and let it sink in.
Like a rushing wind, Jesus, breathe within. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way. Like a mighty storm, stir within my soul. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me.
Like a mighty wind.
Like a rushing wind, Jesus, breathe within. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me. Like a mighty storm, stir within my soul. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me. I surrender. I surrender. I want to know you more. I want to know you more.
Lord, how joyful are those who fear the Lord and delight in obeying His commands. Their children will be successful everywhere. An entire generation of godly people will be blessed. They themselves will be wealthy, and their good deeds will last forever. Light shines in the darkness for the godly. They are generous, compassionate, righteous. Good comes to those who lend money generously, conduct their businesses fairly. Such people will not be overcome by evil. Those who are righteous will be long remembered. They don't fear when bad news comes. They confidently trust in the Lord. He will take care of them. They are confident and fearless and can face their foes triumphantly. They share freely and give generously to those in need. Their good deeds will be remembered forever. They will have influence and honor. The wicked will see this and be infuriated and grind their teeth in anger and sink away, their hopes thwarted. At Psalm 112, it just exalts how God is good and blesses goodness. And we're here to learn to be that way. Amen. Welcome to you. If you're a guest with us, a special welcome to you. If you're online, a special welcome to you as you join us from afar. We're here to meet Jesus, and we're here to understand his good ways in this world. Amen. So let's go before him. If you're comfortable, hold your hands out. If you're not, that's okay too. We're just going to ask the Holy Spirit to come and speak to us. Jesus promised his Holy Spirit would come and convict us of his ways and show us and remind us of all he taught. So, Holy Spirit, we invite you. Holy Spirit, speak and move in every mind and soul here today. We're here to listen and to respond. Friends, may the grace and peace of Jesus our Savior rest on you all through the power of his Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, turn to somebody and greet them in God for a few moments. All right. As you're finding your seat once again, it's good to see so many people in good spirits this morning. You may go ahead and have a seat. Go ahead and have a seat. And I would like to invite the little people, if there are any little people, to come and talk with me for a few minutes. So, you know, kids, over here. I got a bag. Gonna show you stuff. You never know what's in it. You gotta wonder. Okay. Maybe I should sit down here where everybody can see my stuff, huh? Sit down this way. You guys can sit up there. All right. Well, you know, there's a lot of rules, aren't there? You know, about what you can do and you can't do. And sometimes do you feel like you just wish you could do whatever you wanted? Yeah? Yeah? A couple of us feel that way. Have you ever wanted to play in the street? Huh? Yeah?
And I do.
Yeah, and you do. We'll have to have a talk with your dad. I wanted to play in the street when I was little, too. But my parents wouldn't let me. Because, you know, they didn't want me to get run over. What if I made a snowman in the middle of the road? It would get run over. So, I mean, I guess the rules are for your good, right? Do you ever want to stay up all night instead of go to bed? Did anybody ever stay up all night? Have you done it?
Yeah.
Or just stay up really late? How many of you have stayed up like till midnight? Well, or 10 o'clock? 11? You know, I stayed up once late when I was in second grade, and then I slept all through class on my desk the next day. So, you know, when your parents tell you to go to sleep, it's because they care about you, so things go well the next day, right? So the rule is really not bad for you, it's good for you. I was thinking something else, too. Like, do your parents let you play with matches?
I don't like to play with
No? Do your parents let you? No? No? Does anybody want a match?
No.
Nope. I wouldn't let you either, you know, because you might burn something. You know, and that's not good. So it's like a rule keeps you from doing something, but it's for good. See? So I'll put that over here. How about medicine? Do your parents make you take medicine or vitamins?
I have medicine.
You got medicine?
We don't
you don't like your medicine? Have you ever had medicine that tasted yucky?
Yeah.
But you had to have it anyway. Tastes like what?
I drink it with orange juice.
Oh, drink it with orange juice. It's a good idea. You know, but you know what? If you don't take your vitamins or your medicine, you don't get healthy again, right? So it's a good rule, even though it feels like sometimes it's not, right? So, oh, have you ever gone trick-or-treating? Yeah, and did you eat all kinds of candy, like all of it at once? How many of you have ever eaten a lot of candy all at once? You did it, and did you throw up? No? Did you ever get sick from eating too much candy? Did you? Yeah? What? He had a bunch of suckers? Well, how'd you feel? I dare say if I ate all these nerds right now, I would feel sick, you know? Now, my parents would always say, you can't have them all at once. You have to have one or two, nerds are kind of small, but you have to have a little bit, you know, but not all at once because otherwise you get sick. So it's another rule, right? But it's about living good. Just like going to bed is about living good. All those rules, we think that we're not free. They don't let us do what we want. But really, they're making us have a good life. And God is the same way. He's got all kinds of rules for us, but they're not about making us miserable. They're about making us happy and good. So let's just pray, God. Your parents are for making you miserable?
Yeah.
Sometimes we think that, right? I thought that when I was little too. But you know what? When you grow up, you find out it's just not that way. It's because they really love us. And God is the same way. So let's pray and thank God for that, shall we? Lord Jesus, we thank you that you have good rules. You know that there's good things and wrong things, and you tell us so that we can live good lives. And we're grateful for that, Lord, and I pray that you help us all learn that. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you guys can head back to your seats. I think you can go to children's worship if that's where you're headed. And we're going to bring our gifts and share with the world what God has blessed us with. So, deacons, you'll help us do that now. If you're a guest with us today, don't worry about this. Our worship service is a gift to you. So, but if you're a member, this is how we do ministry.
All right, while the offering is being taken, Anna and I are going to sing, and we just invite you to pray the words as we sing.
Louder than the noise, I want to feel you. Closer than the air I breathe. Deeper than my soul burning. Speak to me, let my heart be awakened by the wind. Whispering of love. Pull me close to your heart. Let the silence now be filled with your voice. Found in surrender. My heart is fully yours, caught in the moment. Captivated by the unseen, your loving heart for me revealed. Speak to me, let my heart be awakened by the whispering of love. Pull me close to your heart, let the silence now be filled with your voice. The words I hear you say, you've been speaking out for all of time, all of time.
The words I hear you say, you've been speaking out for all of time, all of time. the silence now be filled with your voice. Speak to me, let my heart be awakened by the whispering of love. Hold me close to your heart, let the silence now be filled.
Oh, that was beautiful, right? So I'm going to use my microphone to talk into instead of sing. So I invite you to go ahead and pray with me. Thanks, Terry. All right, let's pray. God, I just want to start off by looking at all the ways that you're powerful and amazing. Well, not all the ways, I guess, but a few ways. First thing that comes to mind and to sight is that snow. It is beautiful and bright out there. We thank you that while at first it's overwhelmingly bright, but then our eyes adjust, the eyes that you have made that work the ways they do to be able to focus in and observe the beauty and to be affected by it. We also thank you for the fun that snow brings for kids. We also thank you for the ways it brings neighbors together. I've noticed that every time there's a big snow, there's a lot more neighbor interaction, people helping shovel each other's driveways and kids outside and kids connecting and then adults connecting. It's really neat, God, and we thank you for it. We also know that some were affected negatively by it. There were car accidents, huge traffic delays, people stuck at home alone feeling depressed, and some couldn't work, and they don't have the luxury of being paid when they don't work. So we also just, we think of them and ask that you would just be with them in those times. I thank you for the ways that you are with us in the times when they're hard. We also praise you for surgeries. It is just amazing that you have provided us with hospitals and doctors and nurses and researchers. Thank you for the ways that they can help fix at least some of the things that are wrong with our physical bodies. I think of Lisa Vanderkleed with her hernia surgery. Thank you that went well. We know that's a painful recovery. It's great to see her today, and she's looking good. So we thank you for that. Lord, I think of that song, I Surrender, and it makes me realize the importance of confession. So we just pray in a confessing way, asking you to forgive the ways that we often think so selfishly. We're really good at it, and I think a lot of times we're upset by it, too. We don't want to be that way. We want to be better for you and for others around us, so please help us to be disciplined in that and to surrender to you and ask you to take over. We ask that you would forgive the ways we don't trust you sometimes, and we try to take things into our own hands. For some reason, we think that we can do a better job, and time again, we fail at that. And we just thank you that you take us back, actually that you never left us, and you're right by us even while we were trying to handle it. We thank you for the power of your forgiveness, that you remove guilt and shame, that you convict us to change our ways, and that you restore our souls when they felt so broken. Lord, there's others on our hearts who we want to pray for, and we know they're on your heart too, God. We think of Lisa Cooper's sister, who's going to have open heart surgery on Tuesday, I believe. God, that's amazing that doctors can open up our bodies and have our organs right there, and it works. The things that they do work. But it's also scary. We know there's risk involved. So please protect Lisa's sister's heart and her body as the surgeons do their amazing work. Thank you for the skills that you have given to them, and thank you for their commitment to help people. I also pray for Ben Bergsma as he continues through this chemo. Lord, it's hard when someone in their 30s has cancer and has to go through so much treatment for a cancer that we're told is curable, and we thank you for that, but it's still a lot. It's a long road, and we just pray for Ben, for his body, but also for his soul, that he would feel close to you during this time and know that you love him. We pray for Rob Baker, too. We love Rob. We thank you that we have had him in our life, in our lives, and we just love him. We pray for him today. Pray for Carol, that you would just continue to be by their sides. And we thank you that no matter what our circumstances are, that we have you as our hope. We thank you for this current series of hope. You always come through, God, and we trust your ways. We pray for Randy as he shares that hope, that you would provide it to us this morning, whether it's really hard to see or maybe we don't see it at all. We pray that you would reveal your hope to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have one announcement.
I don't know if any of you have noticed how full our stairs have been getting during the children's message, but we're so thankful for all the kids that we've been having come to church over the last several years, and it's been cool to see it grow. And as our stairs fill up, our children's worship classroom fills up, and we have a need. We are seeking adult volunteers to be willing to get tapped on the shoulder on a Sunday morning and asked to step into the classroom and just be an extra set of eyes, ears, and hands. There's no preparation needed. It's simply to help with supervision with those greater numbers. And we're excited. We had 18 kids a few weeks ago. We have 16 today. So that's a lot, and the room is small. So with an additional helper, we can split those kiddos up and give them some better attention and some better teaching of the Lord's Word. So if anybody is willing to be tapped on the shoulder every once in a while and help out in the children's worship room, please let me know. We would really appreciate that. Thanks.
How many of you are good at no preparation? Yeah, all right, so should be somebody who can help us out, right? All right, we're studying through the book of 1 Peter, which is a book all about hope. And we are up to chapter 2, verse 11. And if you want to catch up on like where Peter's theme has been, if you missed it so far, you can go on our website. And you can find all our studies there. I want to start to read then at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11 through 25. And I'm going to tell you right now that what I hope that you see is that Peter is telling us to live a good life, and then there's going to be reasons for that. So you watch for them as we read through the text, okay? Dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world. Remember, we talked about that on week one because the opening verses say the same thing. I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans that, though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every authority instituted among men, whether to the king as the supreme authority or to the governors who are sent by him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. For it is God's will that by doing good you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish men. Live as free men, but do not use your freedom as a cover-up for evil. Live as servants of God. Show proper respect to everyone. Love the brotherhood of believers. Fear God. Honor the king. Slaves, submit yourselves to your masters with all respect, and not only to those who are good and considerate, but also to those who are harsh. For it is commendable if a man bears up under the pain of unjust suffering because he is conscious of God. But how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure that? But if you suffer for doing good and endure it, this is commendable before God. And to this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. Quoted from the Old Testament, he committed no sin. This is Isaiah 53. No deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were like sheep going astray, but now you have returned to the shepherd, the overseer of your souls. Wow, there's so much in there. I mean, Peter quotes from the Old Testament constantly. I want to talk about freedom. I think that I think you will agree that personal freedom is one of our modern day idols. You know, my body, my choice. We hear it on TV. The slogan goes. We're encouraged I read the newspapers, and we're constantly hearing about, you know, be tolerant, be nice, be accepting, let everyone live authentically to who they are comfortable being. You know, that's the jargon. You might have heard of Leah Thomas, a swimmer for the University of Pennsylvania, who, after swimming on the men's team for 3 years, as Will Thomas, now competes on the women's team. And the results have been predictable. As of December, Thomas has recorded the fastest times in women's swimming, college swimming, in the 200 and in the 500 freestyle, and won a 1650-meter freestyle event by nearly 40 seconds ahead of the next person in line. And now, some of the gals on the team at Pennsylvania, University of Pennsylvania, are not so in favor of the free liberal approach to identity. It's tricky, this freedom stuff. We easily distort it. Tim Keller writes it like this: freedom has come to be defined as the absence of any limitations or constraints on us. By definition, the fewer the boundaries we have on our choices and actions, the freer we feel ourselves to be. But that definition isn't workable. It just doesn't work. Let's suppose that a fish feels constrained by the sea and so jumps out of the sea onto the beach and lays there gasping for breath, all the while saying to himself, "I'm free, I'm free." You'd say, "That poor fish needs help getting back into the water where it can really be free." And not surprisingly, our modern culture is a lot like that fish, I think. So take, for example, the recent phenomena, and I don't know if you've run into these, I have, of furries. I don't know if you know what a furry is. That's a person who chooses to dress as an animal and identify as an animal, and then so dress accordingly. And that's a phenomenon that's happening in our culture right now. In the name of authentic living, I want to authentically be who I am. And in the name of allowing authentic living, a lot of other people, perhaps out of the fear of being called a name that ends with phobe, No one cares enough to tell the emperor he's not wearing clothes, much less to help the emperor get dressed. Now, at first glance, our text today does not sound so much like freedom. It doesn't sound like it affirms doing whatever you'd like to do. The apostle Peter tells the first century Christians scattered throughout modern-day Turkey that they need to behave well, be good, honor authority, follow the law, boundaries, you know, even be respectful to unreasonable people. How do you like that one? Unreasonable people. So essentially, Peter is arguing that freedom is not so much the absence of restrictions as it is finding the right ones, the ones that fit with the realities of who we are, what our own nature is, and the realities of the world. And beyond that, Peter is telling us that godliness, good behavior, is more hopeful even than personal freedom. You got that right. Godliness is even more hopeful than personal freedom. And let's look at why that might be. Why be good? Why behave? Now, why should I obey a law that I don't like? You know? Why voluntarily submit my personal freedoms to structures that exist all around me? How we think about these things greatly affects whether we live frustrated lives, unfulfilled, gasping on the beach lives, or whether we live hopeful and grateful lives. How we look at authority or structure or law or morality over against our personal desires, lusts, rights, freedoms is going to affect how hopeful we are. And Peter's going to show us this. So let's consider his teaching in this text. He makes a case for obedient, good, submissive behavior for those who are followers of Jesus. I suggest it helps for anybody, but he's talking to Christians in this book. I'm going to share a couple of his arguments. Argument number one for good behavior is that there's more to life than this. That's argument number one. And that's kind of what we touched on in our first study in this book. But Peter's coming back to it. This life is temporary, he says. Why live a good life as opposed to doing whatever I feel like whenever I want to? Well, first of all, by merely recognizing that some things are good and some things are not, we call it the moral law, merely by recognizing that, we are also admitting there must be some standard, some transcendent standard beyond everybody's opinion. Otherwise, you can't say something is right or wrong. Did you check in our text where it says that God has appointed rulers? Submit yourselves, verse 8. That's not it. Here it is, verse 14. Governors who are sent by, say, the king to punish those who do wrong and commend those who do right. This is what government's supposed to do. So Peter assumes, of course, that there is right, there is wrong, and then therefore there must be a standard from which we get that. However, even though every culture in the world has standards of some things are right and some things are wrong, the strange and interesting part about our world today is that in the Western world, in America, we are beginning to reject that concept altogether. We say, there are no wrong things. There are no right things. It's whatever is good for you or whatever you want. We don't believe in a standard, in a God. And if we don't have an absolute truth, then it's a very small step into not believing that I'm a male or a female, or not believing that I should enforce the law or defund the law. Because who's to say? They just get in the way of our being what we want to be or taking what we want to take. And during the pandemic, we've seen all kinds of news all across our nation of people just taking what they want to take. And I think it's right to do so. Now, if we are merely evolutionary accidents, how do we account for this persistent reality that we feel, namely that some things are not right and some things are right? Well, Christians obviously acknowledge that God's existence alone explains that standard. That being said, why should I be good, or why should I be like God? The short answer is that there's more to all this than this life itself. There's life beyond this life. And incidentally, every culture, every known culture also has some kind of understanding of that. Peter says, it's hopeful to do good because goodness fits with the life that's coming, where everything is going to be good there. The real one, the eternal one. We ought to live like what's going to what ought to be. And we're aliens here, we're on a journey to there, a journey to another life. And you see that in verses 11 and 12. You know, I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world. You know, this is not where we belong. It's not like it's supposed to be. Now I have a question for you. Do you ever feel like that? Do you ever feel like the world is not enough? I believe James Bond felt that way once. Do you ever feel like you don't fit, you know, in, like things are not how they ought to be? You know, do you ever feel any of those things? I suggest that if you do, your spirit is being sensitive to spiritual realities. You are correct. This is a good step to sense that. Now, doing the right thing is not always going to bring us comfort. But that's okay. If there's more to it than this. If there's not more to it than this, Paul himself says in the book of Corinthians, if there's not more to it than this life, we might as well drink it up, people, and party hardy, people, because we might die tomorrow. If there isn't more than this. But Paul says there is, and so does Peter. Okay, so argument number one for good behavior is that there's more to it than this world. All right, the second argument that he gives us, I think, in our text, is that when we live good lives, it gives your soul peace. This reminds me of Pascal's wager. Has anyone ever heard of Pascal's wager? Those of you who study philosophy probably have run into it. Pascal wagered that, isn't it better to choose to believe in God and to follow in his good ways and but obeying his laws, because only goodness comes from that. And if you are wrong at the end of your life, all you did was live a good life. But if you are right that there is not a God and you didn't follow his ways, then you end up in a very bad place. So isn't it just wiser to choose to follow God, even if you're not sure he's there? That's Pascal's wager. You can look it up sometime. Well, bear in mind that good behavior that Peter encourages us and his readers to live is not attempts to get salvation, okay? He does not encourage us to be good to get God to like us or to get God to forgive us. No. That's not the Christian religion. That will never give you peace. If you try to live a life of doing good things to make up for your bad things, you will never be at peace. I'll tell you that right now. The Bible tells us that over and over and over again. Christian goodness is always only a response to the unbelievable free gift of eternal life through Jesus. Amen? That is what the Christian faith is all about. We only do good things to say thank you, God, and also to find peace. It gives your soul peace. See, verse 11, did you see what verse 11 says? Abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. Sinful desires war against your soul. I'll bet a few of us in the room have felt that war against your soul. But conversely then, therefore, godly desires do not war against your soul. They give your soul peace, right? Think of anything that you're doing or have done or whatever that you knew intuitively, I shouldn't be doing this or I shouldn't have done that. And I'll ask yourself a question. Did it fulfill you? Did it fill you up? Did it bring you ultimate satisfaction? Was it enough? Did you feel better about yourself when it was over? Now, the world's answer to this problem, the popular solution, is to disbelieve that there's anything right or wrong at all. And then that way, we don't have to feel bad about what we did or do or say or think, because nothing's right or wrong. But if you look closely, people who choose that option are not very hopeful people. Usually just constantly hungry, never full. The hope-filled life, Peter is telling us, is directly linked to living the godly life. They go together. So why not choose it? Psalm 97, verse 11, puts it like this. Shall we put that on the screen and let's read it all together? Just a short verse. Light shines on the godly and joy on those whose hearts are right. That's pretty simple. When we live rightly, joy is more possible. Now, believe it or not, your soul is just as vulnerable as your body. You take care of your bodies. I can see that, you know, everybody in here takes care of their bodies. Why not take care of your soul? How we live daily affects our soul. Therefore, how we live daily is about more than whether we look good, right? I mean, you all look good right now. Whether we look good or not, whether we're pretty, or whether we have the shoe fashions that are correct, or life is more than that. That's back to our first point. You know, more than being an athlete or getting a degree or being famous, people with all these things still jump off of high buildings. It happened last week to Miss USA. People with all these things can still hurt in their soul. So the next time you fret about whether your makeup is good enough or whether you've won more games than the friend you're competing with, or whether you'll ever be published, or tell yourself, my soul is more than this. My soul is far more than this. In fact, let's just say that out loud. My soul is more than this. Ready? My soul is more than this. Right? It's God says that your soul is of eternal value. It's far more than all this stuff. I must remind us that the true God is a forgiving God, and with a forgiving God, your failure is never final with him. It's never final. He's freely giving goodness because of who he is. And that's why when we do good, it brings peace to our soul. Okay, here's a third argument that I think Peter makes. Why we ought to do good or do right. And that is that it points to God. And this is significant. It's particularly directed to those of you in the room who believe in Jesus. Directed to followers of God. Peter emphasizes verse 12. Look at verse 12. Live such good lives among the pagans. Okay, the word is Gentiles. It means nations. Live good lives among all the nations. That's where he wants us to do it. Our faith is our motive. Pointing to God is the objective, right? Why? Though they accuse you of doing wrong, they say you do wrong things, that though that might be the case, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. That's his rationale. So a believer in Jesus works at living a clean life, not to impress people, but so that other people might want it, want the goodness, and then also discover the source of it, namely God, which we saw in chapter 2, verse 9, right? You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into light. Right? That's the whole point. Point people to God. So, we should ask ourselves, do ask yourself, am I making my faith look desirable, or am I making my faith look undesirable? Because see, we're trying to point to the goodness of God. Now people will inevitably make fun of people who try to live wholesome and upright lives. Just curious, has anyone in the room ever been made fun of for doing the good thing? Yeah, it's inevitable. As an example, you might consider the once wholesome and endearing Hannah Montana, who grew up to be Miley Cyrus. Apparently, mockery of wholesomeness is enough to take a deep toll on people. It's the nature of a sinful world and our own sense of guilt to mock goodness and wholesomeness. But it's not logical. It's our nature, but it's not logical. We make fun of good people or doing good things. But everybody wants good people on their side when things go bad or when things are dangerous or they're in trouble. Peter says, live this wholesome life, these wholesome lives, with the objective that others will be convinced to seek God themselves, because then they'll have peace in their heart. Now, you see that phrase where it says, and glorify God on the day he visits us, in verse 12? So we could interpret that different ways. It could mean that by our example, a pagan person comes to faith on the day of judgment and is saved on the day of judgment because they come to faith. Or that if it's not that day he's talking about, if it's the day that God visits us here in this life, when God comes and invites someone into his family, they respond because they have seen the example, the goodness that helps convince them that God's way is good. Either way, it's the same point. Live like God so that people see and accept God. Respectful behavior is spiritually influential. For example, also, if you respectfully disagree, genuinely are respectful, don't just say, I respectfully disagree, and then be disrespectful about it. If you respectfully disagree with someone, it opens them to consider what you have to say. If you are honoring of an enemy, you can win an audience to have them listen to you. And the opposite is true. Just look at how fast we pass off truth when we discover that someone who taught us the truth, the carrier of the truth, behaved badly. You know, if that leader behaved badly, I easily discount what he said or what she said, right? Don't we do that? So Peter, in verse 16 and 17, basically says, be like a servant, show respect to everyone, love the Christian family too, fear God, honor whoever's in charge. I'd like to apply that to a popular chant that we hear today across America. It's a chant about President Biden. It refers to him as a fellow named Brandon. And if you don't know the background of that, I'm not going to say it, but you can look it up on the internet. Let me just say, this is a crude chant aimed at the position that is the highest office in our nation, the president. That would be entirely unfitting for a Christian ever to do. Is exactly the opposite of what Peter is saying here. Exactly the opposite. God calls us to honor authority for the office that it holds, whether we agree with them or whether they're good people or not. We honor authority. Now, the Bible doesn't say that if we have to go against God's way, we follow it. No, we always follow God's way as opposed to people's way. But look at verse 18 in our text. Say, slaves, submit yourselves. Or you could say, employees, submit yourselves. The whole reason we don't have slaves today is because of the Christian faith. The Christian movement is what's abolished slavery. Submit yourselves to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and considerate. Have you ever been part of a work crew? And they, the boss of the work crew, everyone knew he was, less than liked by everyone. And other people in the crew didn't want to perform just because he didn't like the boss. I've been a part of work crews like that. Verse 18, we're reminded repeatedly in Scripture that God establishes authority or allows authority, even bad authorities. Romans 13, for example. Let's put that up. Let's just read this out loud. Everyone must submit himself, for there is no authority except that which God has established, authorities that exist, but established by God. That's what Paul says in the book of Romans. Peter is saying the same thing here in his letter. Now, it doesn't mean that you don't stand up for what's right or that you don't argue for what's good. It doesn't mean that. It does mean we respect authority and structures and that God allows them. Even in worse places than we live, God allows. Think of, for example, the prophet Daniel. We studied Daniel last year, right? He probably lived in Babylon about 70 years. We know he was about 90 when he died. He was probably a teenager when he was dragged off there. And Daniel obviously did not condone all the beliefs and activities and actions of the king of Babylon. And you can read historically about what those things are. Yeah, and obviously Daniel did not condone that. But yet Daniel served in the court of that king and influenced Babylon and influenced the world still today by what he did. Your witness can nullify or verify your behavior. It can be nullified or verified by your behavior. You can say you're a Christian, but if you have all the same standards and the same habits of everybody else, what does that make them think? What's their conclusion? Christianity don't make no difference, which is bad English, by the way, but it's just a show. This is a put on. Because they don't live any different. Remember when we learned last week that God considers his family the priestly tribe of the world, like the Levites were for the Israelites? A Christian is, we're the priests of the world. Our objective is to bring the two sides, God and people, together. Well, living good lives points to that God. That's Peter's argument. Okay, one final argument, and then we're done. Peter's argument for why should we live good lives? Why should we, you know, do the right thing as opposed to the wrong thing? Peter's answer is, Jesus did it. And look what happened. Look at the result of his life. Let's ponder it for a second, okay? It's the clincher, really, in all this. Everything within you might rebel, right, and fight for your own freedoms and your own desires. This is natural. We don't have to work at that. We want our opinion to win out. But human history shows us that we don't find salvation in chasing our own desire, right? No matter how you define it. Jesus' approach, which brought salvation, Jesus' approach to evil was radically different. His approach was to absorb it in himself. Well, let's just think about that. He suffered instead of demanding his own identity, right? And we know what his identity was. He is God in the flesh. He did not trumpet that or his own worth. Peter says he's our example. Look at verse 21. To this you were called because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow, i.e. you should suffer, you should absorb evil into yourself, not make more of it. What was the end result of Jesus' life? You know, sin was given a death blow. Evil was proved to be the losing choice. Righteousness became possible for us through Christ. Jesus dying made it possible for us to live. What does verse 25 say? Actually, it's not verse 25. I'm looking for the verse that says, by his wounds you are healed. Do you see which one that is? 24. There it is. That's the one. By his wounds you have been healed. So Jesus chose suffering. We get salvation out of that. That's the example that he's saying. That's what works. That's what brings salvation, when you absorb evil instead of returning evil. Now, Peter is quoting here from Isaiah 53. And I want to read an extended passage from Isaiah 53 just to show you how much he's thinking of this passage and to also remind us of what Jesus' example is. Okay, so 600 years before Jesus lived, Isaiah wrote all this, and if you know anything about the life of Christ, you know that it exactly parallels everything that happened to Jesus. So let me read this. Isaiah 53. It's called the suffering servant passage. It says this. In verse 4, it says, "It was our weakness that he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down. We thought his troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced for our rebellion, and he was crushed for our sins, and he was beaten so we could be whole, and he was whipped so we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away." Isn't that in our passage, right? Verse 25. "We have left God's paths to follow our own, and yet the Lord has laid on him," the Messiah, Jesus, "the sins of all of us. He was oppressed and treated harshly, and he never said a word. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and like a sheep is silent before its shears, he didn't even open his mouth. Unjustly condemned, he was led away. No one cared that he died without descendants, that his life was cut short midstream." This is all true of Jesus. He was struck down for the rebellion of my people. He had done no wrong. He had never deceived anyone. But he was buried like a criminal, and he put in a rich man's grave. But it was the Lord's plan to crush him and cause him grief. And yet when his life was made an offering for sin, he's going to have many descendants. He will enjoy a long life. The Lord's good plan will prosper in his hands. And when he sees all that is accomplished by his anguish, he'll be satisfied. And because of his experience, my righteous servant will make it possible for many to be counted righteous, for he will bear all their sins. That's what Peter's thinking about in this chapter. He's thinking about that example is exactly what Jesus did for us on the cross. Died a real human death, bore in the process God's wrath against our sins and our wrongness, what we deserve, so that we humans could live eternally with God after this and even now, which we don't deserve. He's a wounded healer. Now, if Jesus' example can result in this heavenly promise, this heavenly destiny, do we not suppose that if we might follow that example in this life and it would be a better choice? You know? So then your spouse argues with you about something and you could either tell them off or you could absorb the wrath. What would Jesus do? It seems like he absorbs evil instead of returning it, whereas we kind of ricochet it back at each other. God's method is the winning method. Why not choose it? Why don't we? So if you're a Christian, you are called to absorb other people's sins against you. You are called to return good for evil. You are called to leave revenge to God alone. When you get fouled under the basket, you are called not to return the favor. When people tell lies about you, you don't tell lies about them. You know? When people look down on you because you're not as cool as they are, because you didn't go along with a dirty deed or a crime, you take that suffering. You honor law and law enforcers for the office and the responsibility they have, even if you don't particularly like the given person, or maybe not even the law. You do good, whether you suffer for it or not, because it's right. And Peter says, and that is commendable before God. And don't forget, God notices. God notices. So you aim beyond this life. You keep your soul in peace in the process. You point the world to God and as a true source of good, and you be like Jesus. Those are Peter's four arguments. You be like Jesus because his wounds forgave our sin and gave us an eternity as good. And we didn't deserve it. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, We want to thank you for your grace in our lives. We want to thank you for taking our sin. And we've got plenty of it, Lord, we know. And we also know we wouldn't have a hope without you. We want to follow you, Lord. We want to follow you. We can't do it without your Holy Spirit. So I just pray, Lord, that you would flow your Holy Spirit into each heart in this room, and you would empower each heart to choose your example, and to us to be like you are, and to find peace, and to point people to peace, and overcome the wrong in the world. God, but only you can do that. We pray for that now. Amen. All right, praise team's going to come on up. Let me remind you that we have a pastor's class today, or Discovering Sunrise class. That's the class you take if you want to know more about the church. Includes lunch. It'll be today, starting about between 11:15 and 11:30. We'll start depending on when people show up in the room, or whether they have coffee longer. There'll be lunch provided. It's about a three-hour class, but don't worry, it goes pretty quick. So that's happening. Why don't you stand, and let's close out our service in praise to God.
Our Father, Creator, you hold our hearts together. There's no one higher than you. Redeemer, Defender, our great and mighty Savior. There's no one higher than you. You are always with us, gracious to forgive us. By your power we've been set free. And Lord, we stand amazed in your presence, astounded by your mercy and love. Our hands are lifted high in surrender. Your grace for me is always enough. And there is no one higher than our God. There is no one greater than you. Let my life forever praise the glory of your name. There is no one higher than majestic in wonder, you reign with love forever. There's no one higher than you. Your beauty, your splendor, your glory knows no measure. There's no one higher than you. You are always with us, gracious to forgive us. By your power we've been set free. And Lord, we stand amazed in your presence, astounded by your mercy and love. Our hands are lifted high in surrender. Your grace for me is always enough. And there is no one higher than our God. There is no one greater than you. Let my life forever praise the glory of your name. There is no one higher than you.
like our God. There is none more able. Christ our Savior, great and glorious. There is no one higher, no one greater, no one like our God. There is none more able. Christ our Savior, great and glorious. There is no one higher than our God. There is no one greater than you. Let my life forever praise the glory of your name. There is no one higher than you.
Friends, as we stand in the presence of this high God, just ask for his benediction on us. Lord, may your grace and your mercy and your truth lead us through this world. May you shine the light in the darkness for us and for everyone else. In the powerful name of Jesus, let all God's people say, amen. Join us for some fellowship afterwards.
Tears us apart. Your love is like a river flowing.